Thank you.
Mr. Wagner.
Well, I'm going to jump in and tell you I'm supportive of the bill and why the change that we are making here is relatively minor. In terms of balancing rights, we're taking out the home address. I think your bill, as I look at the mock-up amendment, still leaves zip codes. So you've got a name, you've got a zip code. I won't say there are no duplicates, but most people can kind of figure out if the guy down the street or the gal next door has a concealed carry permit based on the name and the zip code. So I don't know that we're necessarily giving up anything with this limited change. What we are doing is avoiding the scenario described by Mr. Paredes, which most of us, I think, would agree is a good thing. With respect to the situation in the Rose and Orange County and the publisher's opposition to it, again, the abuse was readily apparent from the names of the officials and the names of the campaign donors and the names of the friends of the sheriff who were getting these permits, and that's what triggered everybody's investigation into the situation. It wasn't, I don't know which person, which elected official was getting a favor. I have to look at the home address. The problem was readily apparent from the information that remains available under this bill. Now, I might, frankly, if I'm packing, and I'm not going to say whether I am or not, or whether I have weapons in the house or not, I'll leave that up to people to decide and, you know, take their chances. You know, I might want that information out there and use that as a way to scare folks off. But the testimony here today is that it's actually an incentive to show up and maybe rob a home. And I don't think it's an unfair trade-off to say I'll take the middle part, I'll redact the middle part of the information, and I'll leave the name and the zip code there for the public. I think that's the appropriate balance, assuming even we have a right to balance Second Amendment rights, which are pretty cut and dried. But for purposes of this bill, I don't have to decide whether or not we shouldn't balance things. I think the bill is making a balance I can accept. So anyway, that's a long way of saying this bill does an absolutely fantastic job of balancing the concerns and deserves support from this committee. Thank you, Mr. Gray.
And to be clear, though, procedurally, the bill that's before us, it was the bill that was originally introduced. The amendments are not formally in this committee.
Are you going to take the amendments?
Yes, sir. I will take the amendments if the committee deems to move forward today.
Thank you, and I take you at your word. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Lejo.
I just wanted to, first of all, recognize this was a bill that previously had come before the legislature, previously under Assemblymember Dan Loke, I believe, last legislative session. And I was trying to find also a balance between the interests that were articulated here today. Your amendments exclude street names. I'd probably be more comfortable leaving numbers of buildings, houses, apartment numbers off, but including street names. But considering, you know, the bill will still be worked through with these proposed amendments, I'm willing to support it today to allow you to continue to work on it. But just so you know, kind of what I would prefer, it's all about a balancing of how much information is released. And at least including street names allows the public to know a little bit more, but at the same time excluding the actual building or home where the permit carrier resides. So with that, I'll give support to allow you to keep working on this bill.
And what the motion is?
Well, the motion is to move the bill. We have a representation from the author that he will take the amendments there. But
so your motion is due pass to appropriation or to public safety?
To its next stop, whatever that
which
is.
Which would be public safety.
Okay, so
the motion on the table then is due pass.
Unamended with a representation that the author will take the amendments, but due right. pass the bill in its current form to its next designated stop.
So we have a motion. Is there a second? And there is a second. Any further comments? Mr. Gray, you may close.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members, and thank you for the lively discussion on the issue. I think, in fact, the bill is about balance. Certainly, if we're going to infringe on our constitutional rights, there's got to be a compelling state interest. I was moved by some of the comments of the opposition coming into this hearing, which is why I've got mock-up amendments before you. I think there is an argument that some transparency in respect to the donors, the newspaper publisher association, as well as some editorials have raised that issue. Our elected officials handing out permits to folks that are campaign donors. Is that occurring? Should the public have a right to know? Well, they should. But I also put before you members the Secretary of State printout of campaign finance disclosure, which I'm sure many of you are very familiar with. It does not have individual home addresses. It's not available. It has zip codes and cities, and the information is consistent to for a newspaper or the public to scrutinize those decisions through that lens. The other objection that was raised is, are folks, in fact, handing out permits to folks outside of their given jurisdiction? Well, city and zip code allow us to determine that information. Mr. Chair, you raised the issue in respect to consistency. Well, I would certainly suggest that it's not consistent that the DOJ does not release this information for folks that have registered firearms, but only for concealed weapon permits. So the extent to which you and you raised the right of a neighbor to have some understanding of whether their neighbors own or possess firearms, well, they don't have that ability.
No, my point was to disclose to the neighbors the permit to conceal carry, I did not raise the rest of that.
No, nonetheless, strikes me as some inconsistency between the two approaches in both the concealed weapon permit and then the firearm ownership. So I think we've struck some balance here. I've proposed the amendments and would be happy to take them, eliminating just the street address, the street and that detailed information, but remaining zip codes, cities, and identifiable information in the public interest. Would respectfully ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. Let's call the roll.
Stone?
No.
Stone, no. Wagner?
Aye.
Wagner, aye. Alejo? Alejo, aye. Chow? Chu?
No.
Chu, no. Gallagher?
Aye.
Gallagher, aye. Garcia?
Aye.
Holden? Mainshine?
Aye.
Mainshine, aye. O'Donnell?
Has four votes. You need two more, so we'll put that bill on call.
Thank you, sir.
And we are 20 minutes past 11. We had set a special order of business item at 11. So we'll move there now. And do we have an indication of which author signed in first? We have two items, item 2, AB 54, and item 3, AB 1342. I'll note, as I did earlier, that item number 1, AB 52, has been pulled at the request of the author. So, all right, Ms. Olson. We're on item number 2, then AB 54.
Hello, thank you, Mr. Chair and members. It is my pleasure to present to you today Assembly Bill 54. ADA lawsuit abuse is literally plaguing my district and others throughout our state, particularly in the Central Valley, but it has been a statewide challenge. AB 54 has over 30 co-authors and wide bipartisan support. Senator Galgiani, Assemblymember Gray, and I all introduced bills this year on the so-called right to cure. The Press Enterprise in Riverside wrote an editorial on March 19th, and they said in that piece, reforming California's implementation of the Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990 isn't about taking a step back on the rights of the disabled, it's about fairness. And I think that's exactly right. Members, I have a niece with severe disabilities. I want her to be able to access all of our facilities, and we work very hard toward that goal. But what's happening with the abuses of the ADA is not facilitating access for the disabled. It's simply lining the pockets of greedy plaintiffs and attorneys who have no interest in improving accessibility of our businesses, of our government facilities, of our schools, and elsewhere. That's the issue we all have to figure out how to address together so we can increase accessibility in our communities, but so that we can also protect small businesses from what's costing them thousands of dollars and, in many cases, shutting their doors altogether. This is not about wealthy or big businesses getting abused by these unscrupulous lawyers and phony victims. It's the mom and pop, the low income, the minority owners that are the primary targets. This is partly because ADA standards are constantly changing on the state and federal level, making businesses that were previously in compliance become out of compliance. This makes it extremely difficult for small-owned businesses to keep track of the changing regulations and keep on top of them on a regular basis. AB 54 will provide small businesses an opportunity to cure Americans with Disabilities Act accessibility violations within 60 days if construction-related accessibility standards related to the specified violation have changed within the previous 3 years. This will help to keep businesses up to date on current standards and better provide access for all. AB 54 also gives a front-end incentive of a tax credit of up to 50%, not to exceed $250, for CASP certification. This will help encourage businesses to ensure access and eliminate any barriers. Small business owners don't want to turn away customers, but oftentimes businesses are unaware of necessary changes that would make their businesses more accessible. They just need to be shown where there's a violation, and they'll be happy to correct it. A lot of times, after being sued, business owners find themselves without enough money to make the necessary accessibility improvements at all, and they're literally shutting their doors and putting people out of work. As I mentioned before, the last 12 months have been hard on small businesses in my district. One attorney, a convicted pedophile and thief from Arizona, has traveled to California for the past 13 years to sue businesses and make money off of unsuspecting business owners. We've had another lawyer who gave a list of businesses for his client to target in Stanislaus and Merced counties, even though the client has never even visited many of these places. She then filed 22 lawsuits with identical wording, claiming improper disability parking and other barriers keep her from accessing the business. To make matters worse, this client decided to set up a trust fund for all of her earnings from these lawsuits so that the income from the settlements would not affect her qualifications for benefit checks from the government. And I provided all of you with articles that keep records on that case. It is clear that there is a problem with our laws when 12% of the country's disabled population live in California, but over 40% of the lawsuits filed related to the ADA are filed in our state. Many businesses, as I've mentioned, particularly in the Central Valley, have literally shut its doors. Institutions, restaurants that have been in business for decades are no longer operating today in my district because of lawsuits related to the ADA. We have to stop incentivizing this legal extortion. The current ADA system is not providing access. It is only providing an ATM for about 30 or 40 lawyers across the state. Laws on the books prevent access, and they hurt small business and employees the most. AB 54 is a common sense, modest approach that will increase access and allow companies to remain in business, provide jobs, grow our economy, and serve all members of our community, including the disabled. Both sides are passionate about this issue, but it is clear that the status quo is no longer working for any of us. We must increase access for all and create a fair chance for business owners to come into compliance. Before I close, I do have to address a statement that was made on the first page of the committee analysis. In line item 3, it says that this bill inadvertently and unfairly singles out people with disabilities by forcing them to overcome additional and substantial new barriers to the enforcement of their civil rights. And I have to say, it does quite the opposite. If allowing 60 days for a business to come into compliance, to become accessible, is a new barrier, then I'm mind-boggled, because what's happening today is these businesses are never coming into compliance because they're shutting their doors, or if they are coming into compliance, it's many months later after settlements are negotiated or lawsuits are complete. 60 days is much faster than what current law and the current system is providing in terms of accessibility to the disabled members of our community. And I would be remiss if I had not pointed that out. So again, I respectfully request your sincere consideration on this bill. It is so important to the ability of our businesses, of our communities, to be able to increase access for the members of our disabled community, including people like my own niece, and also to make sure that they can continue to provide the jobs that our communities rely on.
And just for clarity, Ms. Olson, you had indicated to me that you are willing to take as author's amendments the amendments recommended on page 13.
I am willing to take the amendments, not thrilled about it, but I truly believe the best thing to do is to keep moving forward if we can, and I look forward to working with you, Mr. Chair, the other members of the committee, and also our stakeholders in support and opposition to see if, as the bill moves forward, we can work to find a system that works for all.
Thank you. All right. Your witnesses in support, please.
Catherine Pettibone, Civil Justice Association of California, in support. We have seen over the years attempts to address the shakedown lawsuits that are occurring. Most small businesses do attempt to comply with the law. Many of this is complicated. Standards change. We've seen a number of bills come through the legislature which have had bipartisan support to address this idea of trying to get businesses to comply, trying to get more access for everybody, but reduce the legal costs for unknowing folks. We thought this was a common sense measure, and we're pleased to support.
Thank you. Next witness, please. Is that okay? Then
members, Tim Shannon, representing the California Apartment Association. We agree with the remarks made by the Civil Justice Association. Urge your aye vote. Thank you.
Thank you. So now if you would just list your name, affiliation, and your support for the bill, I would appreciate that.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Matt Sutton with the California Restaurant Association in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Fred Main on support of the Chamber of Commerce Alliance of Ventura and Santa Barbara County, which have significant hospitality businesses in support of the measure.
Carrie Askew Bailey with the California Grocers Association in support.
Silvio Ferrari with the California Building Industry Association in support.
Tom Scott, California Citizens Against Lawsuit Abuse in support. Anything, tax credits, loans, if it helps get businesses compliant in this state, they need it. Most of these businesses, you know, maybe take away $40,000 when all is said and done, and applaud the Assemblywoman's efforts in this area.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Jim Gross, on behalf of the County of San Diego, in support.
Ken DeVore with the National Federation of Independent Business in support.
Jennifer Barrera, on behalf of the California Chamber of Commerce, in support, and we have identified it as a job creator given its ability to give small businesses the opportunity to dedicate financial resources to improving access for all customers.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Okay, seeing none. And because the author has taken the amendments.
Excuse me.
Please.
Gene Livingston on behalf of State Farm, and it's 2,100 independent small business agents in California in support.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? All right. And as I was saying, the author has taken the recommended amendments on page 13, so there are parts of the bill that are no longer operative, and any testimony with respect to the parts that have been removed is not relevant to the conversation here today. So now witnesses in opposition, please.
I'm David Gaffin. Should I go ahead and speak?
Please. Go ahead.
I'm a professional mediator now, and I'm from Santa Monica, California. I've been a civil rights litigator for 27 years. I had an accident in 1980, put me in a wheelchair, and so I have perspective from both able-bodied and disabled point of views, I think, still. In 1990, we passed the ADA, and it's really changed the civil landscape of this country. In the workplace, in transportation, in public places, in this very room, if you look around, there are so many things here that are here because of the ADA that would not be here before. My whole trip from Santa Monica to flying up here today, I could not have done without major, major accommodations that have been made because of equal access provisions in California law and state. Now, and throughout the country, but really what I've noticed is in traveling a lot outside of California, I can't wait to get back to California. California is the most accessible state in the union. I'm always shocked that there's not simple things like wheelchair ramps and accessible bathrooms when I get out of California. And the reason we have such great access in California is because we have strong laws in California that protect disabled rights. The ADA just goes so far. It says you can bring a lawsuit, you can force a change, and you can get recovery if you know you're going to go back there. But when I go to Santa Fe, New Mexico, I'm going to a restaurant there that's not accessible. I'm not going to be back there, and I can't force that restaurant to change. In California, we allow for damages here in addition to injunctive relief, and that those damages provisions are huge. And I urge you to never mess with those. And I know that there are the previous bill that was pulled had suggested that damages be reduced for disabled access cases, but I hope that none of you ever have to stand behind a law that says discrimination based on disability is worth less than discrimination based on age or sex or race or gender discrimination. Now, who's supposed to enforce the laws in the state of California? Well, guess what? People with disabilities have all been deputized. We've been told that there is no agency that's going to go out and enforce this. It's up to us to do it. So people with disabilities have been told, you want your rights, there they are, go out and get them. That is our enforcement mechanism. And it is acknowledged by both sides of the aisle here that there's a lot of enforcement issues that are just going unaddressed. And a lot of people are bringing lawsuits. And a lot of people aren't. Who are the people bringing lawsuits? Well, like in any spectrum, you're going to find people who are never willing to fight, and you're going to find people who are always willing to fight. On one end of the spectrum, you're going to find somebody who goes and incurs the same disabled access violation every day at his local store, and he's going to turn his head, and he's going to walk away, and he's not going to do anything about it. And that's his choice. He doesn't want to do anything about it, fine. He's leaving a mess for somebody else, that's fine. It's not his responsibility. Somewhere down the middle of the spectrum, you're going to find somebody who does say, you know what, I have to deal with this every day, and it shouldn't have to. I'm going to bring a lawsuit. I'm going to use the civil codes, I'm going to use the ADA, and I'm going to bring a lawsuit. I'm going to force that business to change. And then further down the spectrum, and that's kind of the reason we're here today, is that some people, when they see an ADA violation, they just say, I'm going to do something about it. I'm not going to wait for somebody else to get injured by that ADA violation. I'm going to do something about it. They're empowered by the law to do it. As far as I'm concerned, they're cleaning up a mess that I don't have to walk into. I don't want to spend my life going around suing people. I just want to be able to use the bathroom. I just want to be able to get into a restaurant or get into a hotel or get into a business and shop and get out of there. I'm not looking for ADA violations. Some people are, and that's really making people mad. That's really making people mad. But the first question I want to know when people start complaining about getting hit with ADA lawsuits is, are you complying with the law? Shouldn't that be your very first question? Are you complying with the law? Now, I know that there's a lot of dissension here about people getting hit with lawsuits and for regulations and things that they shouldn't have known about or couldn't have known about or are new. But there's a commission out there, the California Disability Access Commission, and they put out a report, and it's online now, and this is a state commission. And that commission said, of the top type of complaints that are out there, the top 10 complaints, letters, demand letters, they all go to three categories: parking, access into and around inside the business, and access to bathrooms. Now, those things are really kind of obvious, and they should be obvious to any business, including mom and pop businesses. It's not hard to know whether or not you've got a handicapped parking space. It's not hard to know whether you've got an accessible counter. And it certainly isn't hard to know whether you've got an accessible bathroom. Those aren't the major issues that people are bringing claims about. So when I hear people complaining that, oh, I got sued over a light switch, I want to know, is that the only thing you got sued over? Or is there something else that's more major, that's really obvious, that you should have taken care of? And the light switch was thrown in after somebody did a survey and found out you didn't have accessible light switches. And when we're talking about inches sometimes, people say, oh, it was just an inch off. Let me tell you something. If this desk right here was an inch off, I wouldn't be able to sit underneath it. Inches matter. The regulations, the minimum statutory regulations that have been passed matter a great deal. They're the minimum statutory access violations. That means that's the least you can do and still provide access.
Sir, I'm going to need you to wrap up.
Okay, well, I've gotten through mostly what I want to say. I do want to say, I don't, you know, this is 2 days of my time coming up here to talk about access laws. I don't know why people with disabilities have to keep coming back to protect their rights for full and equal access. There are better solutions, tax incentives, for instance, better enforcement, not relying upon people with disabilities to tell businesses, having businesses tell each other what access codes are out there. There are much better methods than trying to take away disability rights to help small businesses that need help. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next witness, please.
Anthony Goldsmith for Californians for Disability Rights. We opposed the bill as introduced. We support it as amended. With my understanding, the amendments leave the bill in its current framework with only the tax incentive issue being still part of the law. That being said,
that's true. That is true.
That being said, the introductory speech by the Honorable Assembly Member brought up a lot of issues that have nothing to do whatsoever with the bill as amended. And I believe those need to be addressed. I believe it is inappropriate in connection with the enforcement of a civil rights law, a longstanding 25-year-old civil rights law that is enjoying its 25th anniversary this year, which we were hoping to celebrate rather than to be here, to bring up, with all due respect, pedophilia as an issue. Terms like drive-by litigation. The concept of trying to criminalize the enforcement of civil rights law and some of the comments made earlier are inappropriate. I am sure that there was an attorney. I'm sure the facts are stated as are true. And I'm sure there are many business owners that are sued who have also committed crimes at some point in their life, maybe horrible crimes. That really isn't the issue. And I believe that comment was so inappropriate that we were almost in position to oppose the bill even as amended. And I would ask that since the Honorable Assembly Member stated she wants to work on the bill going forward, that sort of language and that sort of connection of this law with criminality through uses of that sort of terminology or alleging that's the driving force or the majority interest supporting this law not be part of that going forward conversation. So respectfully, we oppose the bill as introduced. We support it as amended with the great caution that care be taken and for and respect shown for this community. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Cindy Soto, and I live in the city of Long Beach. I do have a job, and I also volunteer for three organizations, two transportation agencies and another affordable housing agency. As you can see, I'm completely paralyzed from below my shoulders, and so accessibility is very, very important to me because I'm very active in my community. In July, we'll be celebrating the 25th anniversary of the ADA. Yet in spite of the passage of that law and also California's accessibility law passed 30 years ago, businesses are still inaccessible to people like me. I will give you an example. I was going down the street the other day where near my office, and all of the businesses on that street are accessible. Their entrances are accessible. Okay, I see one shop, they are being refurbished. So that's great, fine. Okay, now I go and look by that business again. Guess what they did? They raised the floor of the business and added two steps to the entrance. Now it is completely inaccessible to anyone with a mobility device. Now, I mean, come on, they have got to be kidding. So, business owners seem to take like a wait and see if I get caught sort of attitude when it comes to accessibility. But what they don't seem to understand is that access laws are actually civil rights laws. Why should my civil rights be violated or delayed even one day longer just because I was born with a disability? And they refuse to comply with the law. Ramps that are too steep, aisles that are too narrow, and counters that are too high impede my ability to live independently in the community. I urge you to oppose AB 54 unless amended. I do support the tax incentives. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Other witnesses in opposition, if you could give your name, your affiliation, and that you oppose the bill. Appreciate that.
Hello, Margaret Johnson with Disability Rights California. We were opposed to the bill as it was originally structured, although we support tax incentives, and we were opposed for many of the reasons already stated. In particular, we believe that current law serves as a deterrent to noncompliance, and businesses should proactively assess their properties to find and correct barriers rather than having it depend upon individual complaints and lawsuits.
Thank you.
We would really encourage that there be additional incentives for businesses to make modifications up front.
Thank you.
And the tax incentives would help do that. So thank you for agreeing to those amendments.
Thank you. Next witness, please.
Good morning. My name is Hector Ochoa. I work for Southern California Independent Living Center in Los Angeles, and I'm here to oppose the bill.
Thank you.
Hi. My name is Jerry Lopez from Boyle Heights, and I oppose to the bill. Thank you.
Thank you.
Fiona Hensey, Independent Living Resource Center, San Francisco, and our organization strongly opposes AB 54.
Thank you.
Anna Acton, Freed Center for Independent Living. We strongly oppose the bill as originally written. I want proactive access so I can take my 3-year-old out into the community and not have to sue to get that.
Thank you.